how many of you have played with the existing WatchKit so far, or at least have built some apps? Okay, so only two. So I'll give you an introduction of what the current WatchKit does, then I can jump what's new in WatchOS. Obviously, there are a lot of new stuff. I can't cover everything, but we'll see the highlights and what it means to kind of build a watch app, and should you build a watch app, and if you build a watch app, what kind of apps you'll build. We have been doing this meetup for 4 years, but then recently we moved to meetup.com, so I see a lot of new faces. Those of you who haven't met me before, my name is Subh, and I basically organize this meetup. And so you'll see me speaking every now and then. I usually try to have Isaac or some other speakers from the community speak at the event. I currently work in PayPal. I lead the wearables team in PayPal. Outside of my day job, I write for raevangelist.com. If you've been building iOS apps for a few years, you probably have bumped into one or two articles from raevangelist.com. So let's see how we basically build a watch app and what kind of architecture of a watch app. Let me quickly build an app in Xcode 6, then I can show you what's the difference in Xcode 7. So it's like creating any new project. You create a new project. I'll just create a single view project. Those of you who haven't been using Swift, you should use Swift now. This is the time you should learn Swift, because Objective-C is going to go away in a couple of years. Too bad for you who are sticking to Objective-C. Anyway, so this is a normal single view-based app. And to create a watch app, the only thing you need to do is like you have different kind of extensions, like today extension and all, you basically create a new target for those extensions. And in your project here, you just click and select Apple Watch. And you select Apple Watch here. And with the existing version, it won't allow you to change the name. It will automatically pick up a name for you. And you click Finish. So what it did is it created two different things. One is the Watch app itself, and another one is the Watch extension. If you see the Watch app, basically it has a storyboard. This is where you create your user interface. It's basically dragging and dropping stuff. The main thing is this interface controller, and you can have kind of, let's say, you can drag a label. Let's call it Hello World. And there is an extension, which is basically your controller's stain extension. Now, the previous version of WatchKit, what happened is your watch app runs on the watch, the extension runs on your phone, the code of the extension runs on your phone, along with your iPhone app. Obviously, you need to have an iPhone app for all the watch apps that you're going to write. You can't have a watch app without an iPhone app. The same for the new version as well. I'll tell you what's the difference. But the extension runs on your phone, and the app itself runs on your on the watch. Now, what happens is because they are communicating through Bluetooth, and there are a bunch of inputs that Apple didn't provide, and they still don't have for the new OS. Things like keyboard, like you probably won't need a keyboard, but let's say you're building an app for, you're building a calculator app. It's basically you need a calculator, which is probably a bad idea to build on a watch. But let's say you're building a calculator app, and there is no keyboard provided by Apple for the WatchKit. So what, I was experimenting with few ideas earlier, and then for one of the ideas I needed basically some kind of input method. And there's obviously voice commands and all, you can speak with Siri and you can do all those things. But you can have buttons, you can tap buttons, but for calculator, basically the solution that we came up with is a button. Basically you have 1, 2, 9 or 0 or whatever buttons you have, buttons for plus, minus, whatever. Buttons might look tiny, but the thing is that when you tap a button, it goes to your phone, it executes the code, it comes back to your watch and it updates the label. And now it's not very responsive. If you run on a simulator, it might look instant. Once you build it and run it on the actual watch, there's a lag behind it. It's like, okay, you want to calculate quickly what's 100 plus 100, you probably want to wait 5 seconds for that to just calculate 100 plus 100. That's a really big problem that the first version of the watch kit had. But let's run this, just, you know, because you just build a Hello World app on watch, let's see how it looks. Because I have simultaneously 6 and 7 running, but this is the iPhone app, this doesn't have anything. And the watch app, you need to.
So maybe you have to slow down on the target part, like which one you play.
So especially when you select, right? The default one is the phone one. Then you will have at least one. If you select notifications, if your app needs notification, it will have notification. But you remember when I created the target, it asked me whether I want a notification or not. If you don't want notification, you can disable it. And there are basically three ways to present your content in an Apple Watch. One is the app itself, there is notification, and there is glance. Glance is what you see from the bottom. Let's say you are running and you want to quickly. So if I just drag from bottom, I can see different glances here. So those are the glances that quickly present some information to your users. But I'm going to run the watch app. And by default, on previous version, the watch is not displayed. So you just select external display from the simulator. You go to hardware external display and you select your watch display, either 38 or 42, and you run it, and that's how you basically present an app. There are various guidelines here. I can't cover all of them, but you need to know that unlike iPhone, this is a different set of components and need to deal with them separately. For example, on iPhone, you can overlap views on top of each other. You can't overlap things here. This is a flow-based layout they follow. So if I, let's say, drag another label, I can't overlap here. I can put either on top or bottom. If you want to put on the side, you need to use something called group, which is here. You can use a group. You can use a group and then, let's say, put two labels here. And then if you select the group and just change the layout from version to two, the group needs to be horizontal, and then it comes side by side. So that's how you put contents side by side on the existing one. But let's see, what's the difference? What's the difference with the new OS? Now a bunch of these articles opened here. Let me see. Okay. So if you see, this is what I was talking about in Watch OS 1, you had this. You had your extension running on the phone, on the iPhone. Now the biggest difference is on watchOS 2, which is coming up, is still in beta, the extension runs on the watch itself. So which makes things like this calculator app more responsive. You can do things whatever you want to do and it runs on your watch. You can basically, which means you can have some apps that doesn't require the iPhone, right? You can go for a running app or whatever, you can capture data, you can store this data literally on the watch, and you can later sync when it's connected to the iPhone. Now this is the biggest difference on the watchOS 2 from the architecture point of view, but There are a bunch of new things. Let's see what they have covered in the watchOS. But before that, I'll show you a video of a hackathon that I went to right after attending the conference, the WWDC conference. And this is an app we built in like 3-4 hours. So basically, let me talk about the app a little bit. This is a micro donation app, which is like you have an app on your wrist and you are concerned about different causes of, let's say, saving people's life or whatever. So we name the app Smile. But basically, whenever somebody needs some money, there are a lot of donation app or this campaign app out there where you donate certain money, you know, for a cancer patient or something, right? But those are generally people contribute like $100 or, you know, $50, whatever they're capable of. But sometimes some people need some urgent money. Let's say there is an operation that's happening next week and you need to raise some $1,000 or $2,000 within 1 week's time. So the moment you raise this campaign, let's say on a portal, immediately it will broadcast as a notification to all the users who have installed this app. And you can choose to donate $1, $2, $5, whatever you want to donate. And you can have your own threshold. Let's say you want to donate, let's say, maximum up to $20, $50 a month. And once you reach the threshold, then we won't send you a notification. It starts with a notification, basically. And you basically can tap there, donate one, and you should be done. You don't need to even open the app. These are all actionable notifications, and notification is a great use case or great feature of Apple Watch. All the apps that are there on the Watch existing app, they are pretty useless, apart from few. But notification is something that's really useful, and basically if you can provide targeted notification to your users, something that matters to them, then you can probably capture their interest and they will do something. There are apps which are trying to literally port their iPhone app into Watch. They're like literally they're trying to port the features into the Watch app. Then those apps are never going to work. And you'll probably install them and probably delete them after a few days. But those apps are really probably a bad use case for an Apple Watch. Anyway, so you basically tap there and that's done. You get a confirmation that's $1 you paid. Otherwise, you can go to the app, you click on donate, and this is where the digital crown API comes in. You can use the digital crown to change amount, and you'll see some kind of animations are there as well. The first version of WatchKit, to use animations, you needed to use sequence of images. It's like GIF, like you're creating GIF image, you need to use sequence of images to create animations. Whereas you can do some animations here, like scaling, changing color, and all those things, just using groups. But then this rely on a concept that you have different groups here on this page, which are hidden at this moment. Which basically have height 1 or 0. And when I do or tap on something, I display other things. So again, this tells you how many people you have contributed to or donated money for. So this is about the app itself. But with watchOS 2, you can also do this thing called complications, which are basically ways to add custom components to your watch face. The first version did allow you that, so you can create your custom complications on the watch face, if you see what I mean. Now I can see, user can select my complications. If user has selected my complications, then I can update user. Let's say the user is caring about this cause and wants to know how much money this particular campaign has raised over a period of time. And as you they have this thing called time travel, where you can travel back and forth in time, and you can see how much money this person has raised over a period of time. If you see the time, I'm sorry, if you see the amount is kind of changing. And there are different kind of complications you can use, and depending on the clock face. Over here there's a, the normal analog clock is there. You can see a complication on the top of left corner, that the amount is also changing. So complication is another big feature of new watchOS. You have basically, so this was my team. This guy, I think he used to work for Pinterest, or he's still working, and he's a guy from CMU. So this was my team, and we built this app together. And one of the guys in the hackathon is this guy. If you see him, he basically have been building this sampler app for iOS 7 and iOS 8. And look into the number of stars that people have given him. It's like, and he built this watch to sampler, which is a great place to kind of start looking into some of the sample codes. Rather than going to documents, you can literally find more information. So let's see what more is there in the watchOS. You have access to core motion now. You can get the gyroscope, accelerometer data. You can get even parameter data, and you can use them as you want on your apps. One of the very clever use case of core motion I saw in the hackathon, there was one guy who built a drummer app. It's basically you move your hand and it will create music as you move your hand depending on different gestures and how much you are moving on what direction. That's a very, very interesting use case. Let's say you are wearing two Apple Watch in two wrists and you can literally create music just by moving your hand. You can have access to HealthKit data. You can now play audio or video with the watchOS too. So you can, for audio, you can play full podcast. For video, I think they have certain restriction how long video you should play. I think I can't remember the duration, but it's very short. So usually you should use video to display some meaningful content. You shouldn't play a movie. You shouldn't have like a 2GB movie on your Apple Watch. No reason to was there. Then this is picker style. Picker style is for the digital crown. Later I'll show you some more examples of different pickers that are there. Then you can have access to the Taptics engine, which is basically a vibration, the different way the watch vibrates, giving some certain kind of feedback to users. And it has different sounds also. So it's like there are some alert sounds you can give, there are some confirmation sounds you can give. Let's say you have a running app, and based on whether the user hits certain goal, you can play a different, you can use a different haptic. The picker and digital crown, they kind of work in, together. Then you have things like you can now run or make a network call from the watch app itself. Once your iPhone is connected to a Wi-Fi, your watch can connect to that Wi-Fi even though the iPhone is not within the range. So you can make literally NFC wireless session call from the watch, but then they suggest that you shouldn't use it that much, otherwise it will drain the battery. You shouldn't download like 100 MB of file from somewhere. But for meaningful updates, you can use NFC wireless session on the watch itself if it makes sense. For a user to download certain smaller contents on the Apple Watch. And let's see. Showing the crown example. So if you see the storyboard. Okay, I'm running on 6. I need to change to 7. So basically, there is this new component called Picker, which is something similar to your UI Picker view on iOS, but there are different component, different styles that you can choose, and different way how you can fit data to this picker. There is a list style, and there is a sequential style, and there is a stack style. Let's see how they look like. I'm going to select 42 mm. So this is the list view where you can kind of use a digital crown to browse through a different list. It can be text, it can be an emoji, it can be whatever you want, it can be background color. And you can have some kind of guidelines or caption for users depending on what has been selected. For here, if you see, I have a label that gets updated when I select an item. And this is where I'm using a page-based kind of controller. Sequential is generally, I'm using it wrongly here. Sequential is literally being used for sequence of emojis. When you see Apple Watch has different sequence of emoji, I'm not sure whether you've seen the videos. But again, if you have a sequence of image, you can kind of use the sequential to just use a digital crown and present user different contents. Stack, again, this is when I created the demo during the conference, I did it completely wrongly. You should use stack in full screen. These are meant for photos. And as you scroll through, a new photo will appear. Especially, you should use it in full screen. I think I didn't have the full image. Maybe I should do this. But I think the image size is still small. So if it's occupying even more space, then it will look nicer, the kind of effect. So this is the digital crown API. The complications that I was telling, let me run the other app. For complications itself, you can select what kind of families you want to support. Let's say there are different kind of watch face, and each of them have different styles. Whether some of them have two line of text, some of them have round complications, some of them have a smaller text. We'll see those in a while. But this is an analog clock. On the anything that's not part of the clock itself are basically modifiable and can be changed into complication. For example, so I can modify these things. So these are all complications that I can modify, and I can select my custom complication. For example, over here, I think I should have my complications that we created. So this is for the smile app that we used. So I have this thing now in the watch face. The similar is, the control is always with user. User can select what complications make sense to them. And as I go back in time travel, and you can see this complication data being changed. And for complications, you provide a set of data. You can have a beginning and you can have an ending. So basically, whenever the data is not available, it can be grayed out and it won't be displayed. For example, there's a match going on and you want to update user about scores. And only for the duration of the match, it might matter for you to display the score. And when the match is over, it can be grayed out. So similarly, depending on the use case, you can provide a range, time range, for which user can see the complication. For example, if you have an airline app, you might want to update user about the boarding gate. So the user can see the boarding gate, whatever is there, right when they look into the watch face. For this one, the advantage is user doesn't need to tap anything. User just needs to look at the watch face and then they see something. For example, if I go back to the other one, now this one has some more types that I can use. Some of them will have some images, some of them will have some text. And I can modify here. And again, if I go in the time travel mode, I can see the amount being changed. So, and users can find this information. let me see if I'm missing anything. Okay. One of the issues that I faced was installing the OS itself. It was the first week, and then I had to basically give my Apple OS to Apple Store because it didn't boot up after installing the beta OS. But I think this is being fixed in iOS 9 beta 2. So you basically need to install a configuration file. You need to download this configuration file and email to you or something, or download this configuration file on your iPhone, which is running iOS 9 beta 2 at least. And then you can install the configuration file to your Apple Watch, not to the iPhone. You need to install the configuration file to your Apple Watch. Then after that, you will be able to update to watchOS 2. But once you upgrade, there is no going back. So you can, I think, within version 2, you can kind of go back to a different version of watchOS 2. But so far, nobody has figured out how to go back to watchOS 1 from watchOS 2. Let me show you an app that I'm using regularly now. And there are a couple of apps that I use regularly. There are notifications, obviously, which are kind of interesting. Okay. Let me disconnect and connect again. So one of the app that I was using on iPhone is an app called Knock, which is basically you double tap on your phone to unlock the Mac. Now with watchOS, hopefully it works. I can unlock the Mac. Okay, let's do it again. Let's live remove. Takes a while. Usually you don't need to tap so many times, because otherwise it doesn't make sense. And you unlock using just your watch. Now, within the proximity, it detects from the Bluetooth, and you can just, with the tap of button, you can unlock the Mac. Now you can have your password, like 120 digit password, and you don't need to remember that. Any questions from you guys?
One thing, the time travel you mentioned, right?
Yeah.
So for that, if the crown is rotated, then the data, it has to be from the extension or it comes from the watchOS itself? I mean.
So the data you need to have in the extension. Let me show you the app itself. So basically, you have this complication controller, which is part of the extension. You can download a JSON file from network, but that data needs to, you shouldn't download when the user is scrolling the ground. You should have the data available. For this use case, what we have is we just hard coded this data. Uh-huh. If you see, there are literally date points with a label. So it's basically a JSON. It needs to be a JSON format, whatever way. But you need to have a key value mapping with a particular date and time with some value that you want to display. And then you basically show in the complication, depending on what complication family you are supporting, you can display that text. But this data needs to, usually what you need to have is you download the data, store it somewhere locally in the file system, and then fetch it as needed by the watchOS.
And the offline functionality that you mentioned, right? When the iPhone is not around you, so even the saving of some crucial data which I want to send back to the phone later,
yeah,
that also
works. You can have it in the extension. You can save it in the extension. Yeah, because the extension now running on the watch, on the watch, you can but little thing about this is, say, watch, you shouldn't build a very complicated app. You shouldn't store core data, for example, on watch. It's like you shouldn't have a database on the watch. You probably need to have a JSON file where you store minimum data, or a file system where you store But you can literally, I think you can have a core data if I'm not wrong, on the words. I need to check though. But I think you can also have core data. But I think it's an overkill. You shouldn't have a core data on the words. Some file system, some JSON. For example, for the app itself, the conference app, WWDC app, they had an Apple Watch app. So the main app displays all the details of the talks, right? What are the talks, and you can see the slides, you can download the videos and all, everything. Whereas on the Watch app, you can see what are the talks that are happening today. It's like you don't need to see even for the week. You can see what's happening. There's like a stripped down version of all the data that's available. But yeah, if you have a developer license, go and explore this. The videos are really nice. You can watch all the. There's something called watch connectivity, which basically being used to share data between your watch and iPhone app. But other than that, Clockit, which is basically for competition, that's the major thing. Digital Crown API, that's another major thing. Then Core Motion is there, animation is there. You'll see a lot of interesting apps.
The watch connectivity shares the same data with the phone?
You can share certain data with your phone and using the watch connectivity. And there is another way you can do also handoff. It's basically if you want user to do certain thing on the iPhone instead of the watch, you can use the handoff API. So it's basically user is doing something here, and the moment user unlocks, it will go to specific screen of the app. So it's basically you can use the handoff. Watch connectivity, actually I haven't personally explored that much, but I know it's been used to share data between the phone and the watch.
So the watch connectivity, is that something kind of Apple built in replace of the wormhole library?
I'm not sure, I haven't used MMO more.
Okay.
Yeah. And I haven't actually explored the voice connectivity a lot also. But yeah, those are the main updates. You can download the sample app. So
this one, what you mentioned extension, right? So it's just looks like any other extension, like this extension?
You can think of it like that. You can think of it like that. So the MM wormhole is for WatchKit, the first version, or is for...
No, it's a, just search is MM wormhole. So I come across this because I need to do something with my extension. So extension needs to talk to my main app and do some manipulation. So this library does something like say a notification towards the app, so you can use your watch to control your.
I think I saw something similar that was using the peer-to-peer connectivity. I'm not sure if you build using something like this, whether the app will be appropriate or not. But you have officially now connectivity which can do this stuff. So.
So maybe this library will get updated and be replaced by Apple, which is a
maybe. Okay. If nothing else, I would like to invite you guys, if you have anything to share, any new app that you have built that you want to quickly showcase, you can just go and come forward and give a short presentation. And get feedback of your apps that you're building. So Deep is going to say something. Okay. If anyone else?
Maybe you want to talk about your conference. Talk a little bit more regarding your conference.
Yeah, so the conference, I think from...
Is there a website?
Well, the iOSConf, this will be... This iOSConf.sg, but I need to do a lot more here. This is still not the website is not updated, but iOSConf.sg is the website. But if you know iOS Dev Scout Facebook group, this is where most of our daily activities happen. Okay. Thank you.
the app, then you watch extensions to pay your password.
Yeah, right. So, those of you who came from the meetup.com, this is where our regular interaction happens. You should join the group, and we have like, how many, I don't know, 3,000 people now? 2795. And all the discussions are purely related to iOS. We kick out people who, you know, post random stuff. And this is where I'll basically announce the conference. I think in maybe 3-4 days, I'm just sorting out a few final things. A lot of guys are helping me. Isaac is, for example, helping me. There are a bunch of guys from the community who are helping me. But yeah, I think the conference will be super interesting. The guy I was talking about, Javier, I'm not sure if you're following his Twitter. He speaks at Swift Summit. He spoke last year, and he's speaking this year as well. So he previously worked at Payable. He's now with the Fabric team of Twitter. So if you use Fabric or Crashlytics, you know probably about Fabric. So he's one of the main speakers. And he built a watch chess game. It's like a chess game for watch. But he will be speaking about Swift in the conference. There is a few other guys. I can't find their name now. But the other guy who is from Dropbox, he used to previously work at Spotify. So guys who really have worked in a lot of different popular apps. I might speak something related to wearables if I find some time to prepare for a talk. But yeah, look out for the dates and the announcement.
What was that pitch, I guess? Who was the conference here?
24th of October. That's a 24th of October. That's a Saturday, so
October.
Yeah. It's like 3 months from 24th October. Yeah.
The venue? Where?
The venue is still finalizing. It's either it will be held, we're trying for anyways, either School of Computing or ISS, but we still need to get a confirmation. Because this place can't fit like 150, we are planning for 150. Otherwise, the alternative would be the PayPal office, but the PayPal office is also, I don't think whether it can fit 150. If it happens in PayPal, we might need to reduce the number of attendees. So. If no other questions, then thank you all for coming. I'll be here for the next 10-15 minutes. If you have any questions for me, feel free to ask. If you have any questions related to filters, feel free to ask Ajit. And we'll be around for a few minutes more. Thank you all.